for attending our public meeting on the Red Hill fuel tanks. Just like to acknowledge the space that we're in. We're in the Ahupua'a of Moanalua, in the Moku, the Ewa Moku. Our area of focus, we know it today as Red Hill, but traditionally, it is known as Kapuka Ki. We're going to talk a little bit, and we have some speakers that we've invited that are going to share some information about the importance of the water, the updates of some of the reports that are going on. But before we get into our panel, I would just like to, again, mahalo you guys, but point to you guys to our agenda. So on our agenda, we're going to go over, get started at 6:15, go over our norms and our protocol. At 6:30, we'll do our Red Hill presentation. At 6:45, our panel discussion will begin. At 7:20, about that time, our community Q&A. And then we'll be closing right around 8. I would like to open up this space and just acknowledge this space that we're going to go into with some agreements. If everyone like to agree to these things, okay? As a community organizer, we host a lot of small, medium-sized, and big group meetings. And what we found to be effective in these group meetings is each group is unique and dynamic in itself. And what really helps to maximize the time and effectiveness is to have some norms and agreements that we can all collectively agree to, okay? Now, we've prepared some norms and agreements, and so one of the first thing is to be respectful. That goes without saying. A lot of these is silence your cell phones. We have this thing called one mic, yeah? And that's the attention to that person that is speaking, that person that has the mic, and be mindful of the time. We're going to ask you an opportunity to ask the questions. So please, you know, have these norms and agreements in consideration and be respectful of each other's time. So can we all agree to some of these things up on this board?
Yeah.
Right on. Is there any norms or agreements that this group that we would like to add onto this board here before we get started? Okay. Well, mahalo each and every one of you for again coming out here at the Sierra Club of Hawaii. We have begun to address, have our position known, and we're going to share with our position, but this is an opportunity for us to also bring on the experts, subject knowledge experts of the Department of Health and the Board of Water Supply, as well as our speaker from the Pearl Harbor Restoration Advisory Board. But before I get to our community panel, I'd like to introduce you to somebody who is helping us direct this lead on Red Hill. She's our director of Sierra Club of Hawaii. She's gonna give a presentation, a synopsis on Red Hill. I want you guys to give a hand for our director, Marty Townsend.
January, 27,000 gallons of jet fuel was released. Since then, there's
force formed by the legislature. And I just want to acknowledge the legislators in the room and thank them for stepping up to the extent that they could, forming the task force, funding positions for the Department of Health, and really helping to keep public attention on the issue of red pill, ensuring that we can at least do what we can at the state level to address this issue. As the task force was formed, there's a lot of negotiations and an agreement was signed between the U.S. Navy, the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, and the State Department of Health. And this agreement, referred to as the AOC, Administrative Order on Consent, is supposed to drive decision-making about the red pill fuel tanks. And this AOC outlined a timeline of 20 years to address this issue of the fuel tanks, a timeline that the Sierra Club, me, our volunteers, wage long. We're unhappy with how long that it's going to take, and we're committed to working with the agencies to see if we can shorten that timeline. I think there are things that we can do to speed up some of our actions that we take and shorten the risk of exposure to our groundwater. And I should also just establish, make sure that everyone knows these 20 fuel tanks that are inside Red Hill, with one of which leaked in January 2014, are 100 feet above the primary aquifer for Oahu. It serves one-fourth of Oahu's population. It's ginormous. There is active drinking wells in Halawa, which is more than a mile off to the EPA side of the Red Hill tanks. And then there's also a drinking well that the Navy uses, which is Makai of the Red Hill fuel tanks. And we're concerned because monitoring has been done since that last leak, and a lot of research. And we're finding, one, that there are spikes in certain contaminants being found in monitoring wells. And I just want to stress here, our drinking water is not currently affected. It is safe to drink your drinking water. Our concern is about 20, 30, 40, 50 years from now, what have we exposed our drinking water resources to? So the Sierra Club has outlined some of our concerns, just to help people keep an idea what they are. Let me wake my computer up again. So in our study, we found that not only has 27,000 gallons of jet fuel leaked in January, but there have been several leaks throughout the years. These tanks were built in 1943, completed in 1943, and all of them demonstrate evidence of having leaked. And this isn't the largest leak. So far, the largest leak that we are aware of is 32,000 gallons from tank one in 1983. And there's some documentation about the leaks that were discovered prior to the jet fuel tanks becoming public. But we don't know a whole lot during that phase between 1943 and up to the early 90s when the jet fuel tanks became public knowledge. And so we're concerned. All of the tanks have demonstrated history of leaking. At least three of the tanks are offline right now, and one of them due to leaking, and I think the other one is also offline due to leaking. And we are concerned that the other tanks pose a risk to the groundwater aquifer. And so we are asking that there be double lining, that leaks be 100% prevented, not just better detected. That's an important distinction. For the Navy, they have talked a lot about how they're improving detection, which is a good thing. But detection means that the fuel has already reached the environment, and that's not okay for us. And so we want to see 100% leak prevention. We also want to see monitoring increased. What we're seeing, the trend in the AOC, is they are slowly negotiating this document and adding more detail, is that they are actually reducing their responsibility in terms of monitoring. So they've reduced the scope or the number of contaminants that they will study for from 64 to 12. And they're also raising the threshold levels that they would have to take action on. And so that allows the Navy to say that, well, while, for example, for diesel fuel, everywhere else it's 100 micrograms per unit that it requires action. It's 100 micrograms per unit of diesel is within the environment, you have to do something. And for several sites around Red Hill, it's 4,500 micrograms per unit, and that just blows our mind. And if that's the trend that we're going to have in how we're going to implement the AOC, the CRCOP has serious concerns. And we want to see more of a commitment to clean up. We recognize that this is a challenge, but we don't see it being a priority. We're already down to Section 8 in negotiations of the AOC, and cleanup has not been demonstrated as a priority. And it's something that we feel at the Sierra Club needs to be the priority action that we take. And so this is a rundown of our basic concerns. There's a handout at the front that we encourage you all to take with you. And there's paper on your tables to answer questions, or you can write questions down if you don't want to read them off yourself. Feel free to give them to one of us and we can ask them. The whole point of this meeting is for us to get together and have a healthy exchange of ideas. And so we encourage you to please ask questions, and including starting with me, if you have any. And if not, thank you very much for being here, and I want to introduce Pulama. Pulama Long is our intern at the Sierra Club employee, and she helped organize this event, and she will introduce her panelists. Thank you very much.
Sites that they have within the Pearl Harbor complex. But I'm not a scientist, a geo-hydrologist or a toxicologist or anything like that. So I'm just speaking as a concerned community member that's concerned about justice, questions of justice, and questions of environmental sustainability. First thing I want to start out with is just to kind of frame the question here. I want to talk about water itself and what it means to us. So I have a little clip I want to play here. Just kind of a little bit of history about this region, looking at the old 1873 map of Kualoa, again, you can see the wetlands, you can see the fish ponds. And that's what made Epa one of the food baskets for Oahu. Yeah? It had one of the highest concentrations, again, of fish ponds, producing 10 to 15 tons of fish a month. And it had the largest variety of shellfish. Now, one of the concerns I have is always the military impacts on the land. It's not just the Red Hill site that we're talking about. So if you look at military land holdings, they have approximately 240,000 acres in the islands. On the island of Oahu, it's about a quarter of our land is controlled by U.S. military. If you look at the formerly used defense sites on Oahu, many of those are contaminated, and it's going to take decades, if not centuries, at the rate that they're going to actually address and clean up many of these sites. And so the food basket of Oahu became the Superfund site that Pearl Harbor is now. I don't have a firm figure because the numbers keep changing and it depends on how you count sites. But at one time I looked through the list and it was something like 748 individual sites within the Pearl Harbor complex alone. And so now, you know, we can't eat those fish, what this resource was known for. And so there's a whole toxic cocktail of chemicals that are in our environment and that could affect the environment as well as health. One example of that, which relates to groundwater, is the Aiea laundry site, which is a Navy laundry site, right in between St. Elizabeth Church and the Aiea Elementary School. There's diesel fuel on the groundwater and also perchloroethylene, a solvent. So the diesel has been relatively contained and they're extracting it with pumps and other methods, but the perchloroethylene hit the groundwater and it's just moving. So it's actually migrated out into the harbor and they're getting hits from the monitoring wells in the water. And the remedy, though, this is the part that baffled me as a layperson, monitored natural attenuation. But what is that? You know? So it's to watch and to let nature take its course, which you know, is to me problematic. Another one is the Schofield Superfund site, which was, again, solvent was found in the drinking water. And it affected all the people on the base and possibly people in the surrounding community. The EPA delisted this site because the Army installed these air filters. They kind of percolate the water to extract this solvent. But they haven't actually cleaned up the source underground. They never found it. And so I'll just skim through these because I know Ernie will be talking about these in their slides. But just to see how close these aquifers are to this radio site. The high levels in the pink, you see the high levels of contaminants that were detected. Again, more monitoring well readings. And this one from the Navy shows the gradient. So those arrows are showing which way the water is moving underground, which is directly towards that Halaba shaft. And that's a great concern. So I guess one point I want to make is to consider cumulative impacts, the kind of combined impacts of over time, but also geographically, right? It's not just this site, but it's also how it's interacting with other sites. It's logistic effects of these impacts. And so these are all things that are often not taken into consideration. The other thing that I want to mention is the idea of precautionary principle. In the US, risk assessment is the main sort of method of driving decisions. And that's also factoring in costs and benefits. And it becomes much more of a political economic decision, whereas the precautionary principle says that acknowledges that there's uncertainty in the science, uncertainty in the complex interactions of nature. So if there's any chance that something could have unacceptable harm, then we should err on the side of caution. And I think that this is a case where you've got one of the main aquifers for Oahu, and you've got 250 million gallons of fuel sitting over it. That's not a good position to be in. I think we need to take precaution to heart. So in concluding, again, water is a precious resource that needs to be vigorously defended and protected as a sacred element of life, and so that's the public trust aspect. The stakes are extremely high because there's a threat to the major drinking water source for Honolulu. Cumulative impacts over time and across space, the synergistic effects, increase the complexity of the risk, but also the vulnerability of those people and environments that are affected. The uncertainty factor, we have to acknowledge that there's a lot of things that they don't know. That's why there's more studies being done. And so these, this is where we can also demand that a precaution is applied to decision making. And just to conclude that it's all political, right? It's always political, even in the assumptions that are made, what facts are not included in making decisions, what decisions are made on the basis of available funding, right? These are all political decisions. So that means this is the role that I think the community has to play, is that it has to also be our role to make these things a priority for officials. And that's, you know, the only reason why we have responses to this kind of contaminants is because people spoke up and demanded it. And so I think it's another situation where if the community doesn't get educated and mobilized, it's not going to put enough pressure to make sure that the money is available to do those cleanups. Thank you very much. Thank you.
The real focus is utmost, the most important thing is protecting our groundwater resource. We also have to make sure that if they're going to continue to operate, they need to do it in a protected manner. And the Navy, the defense, the Navy owns the facility. The Defense Logistics Agency owns the fuel. So there are the two parties from the military that signed this agreement. And it's their responsibility to reduce the risk of future releases, investigate and clean up, protect the drinking water supplies, and all through every step, they have to receive approval from DOH and EPA. Now, one will ask, well, how can we actually enforce this so-called volunteer administrative order of consent? And while there are monetary penalties, if the Navy fails to meet certain schedules, they're subject to penalties. Granted, small penalties, $5,000, $10,000, but the focus is that they have to respond and explain why they haven't done those things. There is a dispute resolution process. One of the key things is that not all parties may agree to remedies or moving forward. And so there is a three-step process which ultimately lands on the desk of the regional assistant administrator of the Office of Underground Storage Tanks in Washington that will weigh the final decision and become continue having an impasse to make a decision. One of the key elements of the agreement on consent is the statement of work, or what we call the scope of work, with details. Seven key elements that have to be done by the Navy. The first one is conducting the tank inspection, repair, and maintenance. Now, one of the things we found out in going back and looking at tank number five is that the contractors did a very bad job. They had done previous tanks in the past, but there were faulty workmanship and inspections, and that is probably the main cause for poor workmanship and ultimately releases. Section three is called the once we had the signed agreement, one of the first things we did was within 60 days to the Navy and all parties. So in 2015, November, December 2015, we had about 55 participants converge at the Navy facility. This included EPA, DOH, we had outside consultants we hired, we had the Navy, Navy facility in Hawaii, Navy Pacific, our region of Pacific area, XWIC, one of their research groups, FLC, the people who control the fuel. We even had retired Navy people come out of mothballs to basically provide assistance, and a whole host of consultants hired by the Navy. One of the key elements in AOC is the involvement of external subject matter experts, and our attempt here is to flip over next. To the people we found key to include was the Department of Natural Resources, the USGS, and the Honolulu Board of Water Supply. It's not until May of this year we were able to actually get everybody in the same room, where the outside subject matter experts, the consultants, to really facilitate the exchange of information and to understand what has been happening in Radio for the last 73 years. Section two, the key findings again was quality assurance and poor control procedures. So the next step in section two is how to improve this process. What things can the Navy do if they're going to continue operating? What kind of inspection, repair, maintenance cycles can they do? A lot of old pictures from the Navy archives. Tank upgrade considerations. Section three, it's looking at how can we contain the fuel effectively. Try to identify the condition of the existing structure. We have concrete that's anywhere from 3.5 to 2 feet thick, and inside there we have a 1/4-inch steel that comprises the tanks. looking at the risk and vulnerability. What things could possibly happen to this facility? Earthquakes, you know, a fire occurring inside the tank. All these things have to be looked at in combination. You can't simply looking at the groundwater, looking at the tank, or looking at the inspection. All these things have to be incorporated, because a solution probably involves a combination of different improvements. Section 4. Release detection and tank tightness testing. This is a key issue, because like our conventional service station, the one right around the corner here, they have monitoring systems that would detect if a release occurs. So the thing is the Navy able to use that kind of technology or something of a higher level to provide adequate frequency of testing, a precision, let's move on. Section 6 and 7 are critical things, because that focus on what has already happened, what has happened with the release. And Section 7, I think, is a critical thing, is because we are looking at what is happening to the area outside the tank. And I'm going to go through this picture here. This is a picture of the 20 underground storage tanks. The blue dots represent existing groundwater monitoring wells. The two, if you look above number 8, there are two blue dots. Those were installed in 2014. We have fairly little data about it, but it shows very, very low indications of petroleum products there, to a point where it's almost non-detectable. In our meetings in December last year, first thing Navy said, yeah, we agree, there's not a lot of information to give us a bigger picture of what's happening in this location. So they actually proposed to do 4 additional wells. So well number 8 and 9 actually being constructed. Well number 8 was actually constructed last week. We completed that work. Well number 9, which is the Moanalua side of Redfield, is I think they're going to begin construction late this week. But these two wells are critical in looking at is the spread. The Navy is always taking the approach that it follows a blue dot straight down to the drinking water well. And a lot of us are not convinced that that is really true, that there could be actually movement outside the well field. By the end of the year, we'll be able to put in well number 10 and number 11. Number 11, I think, is a critical thing to look at. What are the effects of South Halaba and North Halaba Street? Do they actually create barriers that protect contamination moving northwest or north toward the Halaba wells? We talked briefly about contaminants of potential concern. Since 2005, the Navy's been testing 64 different things, and 52 of them basically showed very little, not just trace or even background levels. And so we're wanting to focus on the 12 contaminants and some additional chemicals. We're looking at lead scavengers, which possibly could be present from the use of leaded gasoline back in the 1960s. And if I can move to risk vulnerability. The last thing we have is the most critical thing, because this really wraps everything up in the AOC. Looking at the risk related to the different activities, tank upgrades, tank inspection repair, and it becomes a balance again. And so we're looking at what factors could potentially cause a release. 72-year-old tank, piping, a lot of it is exposed to some of them. It's been burning concrete for 73 years. Could be more investigation, maybe making changes in actual earth infrastructure to improve and have better detection capability. And finally, the last thing I want to say is up and coming events. In August 29th of this year, Board of Water Supply and Department of Health will be traveling to San Francisco to meet with have a room booked between 6:30 and 9. And on October 6th, actually, morning October 6th, we are convening the Fuel Advisory Committee meeting that's stated in House Bill 2646. So, if anybody asks, what does jet fuel look like? It's a clear stuff on the left-hand side of this picture. Next to it is your diesel that is used in fuel trucks. Heating oil, which is actually the same thing as diesel, except it's colored because people in the mainland that use it, they don't pay taxes on it, so you're not supposed to use it in your cars. There's a federal penalty for doing that. On the far right, you see our gasoline, and blue-tinted fuel is aviation gas, which is still used today, and was stored in Red Hill back probably in the 1960s. Okay. Sorry for going over time.
No, you're fine.
Including aviation gas, included leaded motor gasoline,
bunker oil, fuel oil, that used to power the ships of World War II, and now holds jet fuel and diesel. The other point I want to say is that it is very clear on our review of Navy studies and chemical tests that has been done since 2005 when they first drilled those monitor wells or those test wells. A monitor well is really a hole in the ground that is dug all the way down to the water table, so you're able to grab a sample from near the top of the water table underground. And they were able to run chemical analysis on that water sample and determine what kind of chemicals they could find. Since 2005, their data has shown the presence of fuel constituents in the groundwater below the facility and near the facility. And also, Steve talked in detail about the AOC. Currently, that is the legal process that we're trying to work with. I want to be clear, Board of Water Supply does not have a regulatory responsibility or authority in this situation. I guess if we did, we would be taking a slightly different tack, be much more aggressive in the situation. But BWS is just a subject matter expert or a stakeholder in this discussion. And we've been providing our comments for the last 2 years to the EPA, to the Department of Health, to the Navy, to our elected officials, to the public. We've been providing our comments, and it's available on our website, boardofwatersupply.com. I must apologize, our website is being redesigned right now, so it's a little difficult to find that information on Red Hill, but it's there under the community tab, looking for news, and you'll see a link to the Red Hill information. We'll work on improving that when I go back to work next week, or this week. Like Kyle said, the Red Hill facility sits right over the potable water aquifer underground, and it's between the Waimalu and Moanalua aquifer systems. That's a map done by the State Water Commission, and you can see the Red Hill facility sits like at the boundary. And this is a high-quality drinking water aquifer. You could basically drill a well in that aquifer, and with chlorination, you could drink it. Unfortunately, right now, I wouldn't drink the water that would be developed out of a well near Red Hill fuel tanks, because it does have petroleum in the water. What Kyle mentioned is, in blue, this is a very busy slide, but you can see our BWS wells in the area. The closest one is within 5,000 feet to the northwest of them. These are the tanks here, these black dots. This red line outlines the main parcel for the Red Hill facility. So our closest large source to the northwest is Halawa Shaft, but we have a number of other wells in this area here. And the Navy has their own drinking water source that's, I think, around 3,000 feet or so within downhill of the Red Hill fuel tanks. To the south, we have our Moanalua wells. And between Moanalua wells and Halawa Shaft, it provides about 25% of the water for urban Honolulu, stretching from Moanalua all the way out to Hawaii. So those are very important water sources for us. And right now, we are not detecting any fuel in it. We are testing every quarter, and we'll be doing that as long as the facility is in operation, and maybe even beyond. Because the fuel facility there's fuel stored in the tanks, but there's clear evidence that fuel has leaked out into the groundwater, and it's being detected in the groundwater. January 2014 was when Aaron and I's lives changed. And for the last 2 years, since that 27,000 gallon leak, we've been living and breathing Red Hill. I gotta say that's our commitment to our community, to you folks, because it's our job to malama the water, and we need to play that stewardship role, although sometimes it's an unpopular role, because we're pressing the owner of the facility, we're pressing the regulators to do something about it and prevent further contamination of the groundwater, and also clean up what is already in the ground, in the water. But that's very important. had said earlier, the groundwater is really, Marty said, this is a like a side view of those tanks underground. So if you cut the ridge, a line down the ridge, you would see the, these tanks in two rows of 10. And the bottom of the tank is around 100 feet above the top of the water table underground. Next. It's really hard to see, but in investigations in 1990 to 2002, the Navy drilled rock cores under the tanks. And what they discovered in 19 of the 20 cores that were taken out of those cores under the, directly under the fuel tanks, 19 were stained black because of fuel contamination. At that point, I think they called the Department of Health and notified Steve about that situation. So there has been, this is clear evidence of, that the tanks have been leaking over the 73-year history. The question is, and it's really hard to tell, it's really unknown how much is leaked from each tank, when did it leak, because documentation and reports haven't been fully made available to us, or maybe it doesn't even exist. Next, please. We discovered this document, I think it was last year, through a Freedom of Information Act to the Defense Logistics Agency, which also, which like somebody pointed out, I think it was Steve, the tanks are owned by the Navy, the facility, but the fuel facility is owned by the Federal Defense Logistics Agency, part of the Defense. This is a, actually, 2010 audit of the Navy Red Hill facility that was done by the Naval Audit Service, a separate group from the group that operates Pearl Harbor. And these are some of their conclusions from this audit report. Groundwater contamination resulting from irregular maintenance and insufficient inspection, delays in completion of the maintenance cycle due to operational time constraints, inability of current leak detection methods to detect slow, chronic fuel leaks, non-compliance with terms of the State Department of Health approved Navy Groundwater Protection Plan. This wasn't Board of Water Supply reaching these conclusions. This was the Navy's own audit service when they did an audit for this facility. Hopefully some of these have been addressed by the Navy in the interim 6 years, but this report still stands. Next, please. And it's also available on our website. This is really hard to see, but the thing to focus on is this pink box here. Of all the different monitor level locations where they're taking water samples and they're testing those samples for chemicals, this red box, which is this monitor well, that's located actually in the lower access tunnel, directly closest to tank number 5, has actually the highest levels of TPH, or total petroleum hydrocarbons diesel, of all the test locations. And right now they have about 10 test locations. They are drilling more wells, so that'll up the number of test locations. Next, please. I'm sorry, these are monitoring wells now outside the facility. And you can see that we're detecting fuel, the Navy's actually detecting fuel in these monitoring wells as far as 1,000 feet away from the fuel tanks to the northwest. And that is concerning to the Board of Water Supply. I'm sorry, I'm talking to this mic and sometimes I go loud and sometimes I go soft, so I really apologize for that. But, to me, that's clear evidence that fuel is migrating off the Navy property and it is heading toward the northwest. The issue is, of concerns are, I think Kyle pointed it out, that not only can the fuel reach our drinking water wells and require us to now abandon those wells or put in expensive treatment systems to remove the fuel so that it's suitable for drinking, but also we have to keep in mind that it's the principle that water flows from Mauka to Makai. So where's the Makai that's closest to this area? That's Pearl Harbor. So if there is a large fuel leak, like in the millions of gallons, remember there's 187 million plus gallons of fuel stored there right now, which is actually more than we're pumping to provide 1 million people on Oahu. We pump about 145 million gallons a day. It's 187 million plus is stored right now in those 73-year-old tanks. And if there was a catastrophic leak, perhaps due to an earthquake, which shook the steel plates and caused the steel plates in the tanks to leak, or the pipeline that leads to Pearl Harbor to leak. If millions of gallons leaked, where would it end up? It would be a threat potentially to our drinking water wells, and that's what we're trying to investigate. But will fuel eventually end up in Pearl Harbor, into the wetland areas of Pearl Harbor, and actually show up there later? As a young man, I used to work on my uncle's tower farm in Pearl Ridge and Pearl, and there was a leak upstream. I think it was at least maybe 1,000 feet away of a gas station where, you used to remember Penny's? Penny's used to have a gas station. They leaked fuels. And that fuel, that gasoline, ended up in the low unit downstream, closer to Pearl Harbor, above the steam water reservoir. And that went on for years. So I can imagine if the fuel leak at Red Hill is in the millions of gallons, or even a million gallons, how long would it take to get it out of the groundwater? It would easily go beyond my lifetime, and perhaps even a long, long time. So we want to prevent that from happening. Prevention is the best solution here for Red Hill. Either the Navy needs to upgrade that facility, and we're providing as many suggestions as we can on what the best course of action is to prevent leaks like double lining the tanks, leak detection systems, remediate what's already leaked into the ground so it doesn't spread, or you know the other options are, which we want them to explore in this ALC process. We've suggested to also look at the cost benefit of relocation of the fuel in part or in total to other locations. At least look at that alternative in the ALC process. And when we go up to San Francisco in September, end of this month, now those are one of the things we're going to keep on pushing, especially in Section 8 of the statement of order, that they need to look at all the alternatives. Next season. This is a graph, and Erwin had to actually read the numbers from about 10 years plus to plot this out, because we asked for this graph, but nobody was able to provide it, so Erwin took the time to, I think his spreadsheet stretched 10 or 15 feet long with the numbers that he had to actually plot into this graph. But what you can see most concerning is this is TPH diesel out of monitor well, Redwood Hill monitor well number two. Since the beginning of 2014, this levels of TPH diesel has continually risen up. In fact, it's currently in its latest test results taken as of January of this year, the number was 6,500 parts per million, higher than in the last 10 years of record. So look at this trend. It is very concerning to us. We've asked the questions of the Department of Health and the EPA, what's happening here? Could it be other leaks that have happened that have not been reported? What is going on that causes the TPH diesel in the well, monitor well that is closest to tank number five, which is currently empty, to continue to rise, and the China trend is definitely upwards. Next, please. So our concern simply, and I apologize if it's been a little too complicated, it's our challenge of how do we communicate this issue to our community so everybody can understand it. We're still concerned, and this is our concern from the very beginning when the ALC was proposed, and we provided those comments that it allows too long to a time period for the improvements or the fixes to these tanks, the upgrades of the tanks to occur, anywhere between 22 and 27 years. No, there aren't a lot of specifics at this point. It allows 2 years to do studies. Once the scope of work or the work plans have been approved, that's when the clock for the 2 years actually starts. And a lot of the studies we believe have already been done in the last 73 years on this facility. Public transparency and participation opportunity is lacking. The public only will see a summary of the work, but the work discussions are not really open to the public. There was discussions last December, and Steve shared about that. We didn't participate in those discussions last December because we were being faced with the requirement to sign a non-disclosure agreement. And we felt that that is fundamentally against transparency. So we stayed our ground. And I would like to just compliment the Navy Department of Health and EPA. They've now created a process to allow us to participate and share our Moanalua without having to sign a non-disclosure or confidentiality agreement. We believe that's a step in the right direction. EPA has a website, although it's not the easiest one to use, at epa.gov/red-hill. And hopefully all the documents are on that website, but you'll have to really work to get the information out on the website. And the bottom line question, will this ALC SOW process eliminate the risk to our drinking water supply? There is no substitute for pure water. You know, I look at these banners here for our children of taking courage, kindness, character, honesty, and there's character twice. But this is why we work so hard for our community. And these are the values that our KPO are learning that we as adults, we need to carry on them and set the example for the generations to come. So, mahalo everybody. I know I took too long, but mahalo for coming out tonight. And thank you to the Sierra Club for hosting this. Mahalo.
Communicating and engaging with the community and sharing in the discussion of the situation on Red Hill. So at this point now we're going to do a Q&A. So we're going to have a microphone that's going to be coming around, so you just need to raise your hand. And Quincy, where's Quincy? He's going to be
Thank you. chemical of that instruction 59.1 delta. If you compare that, that sets up all the negative regulations and requirements that you have to do in a spill, public notification, and tanks. If you compare that document against your VOC, you're going to find that you're less stringent than VOC. The requirements set out in that document, which they should have followed, this would never happen. The other observation I noticed is that you don't have to babysit the Navy. All you have to do is be the parent and just tell them it's unacceptable. You're big boys, you can figure it out. Because the Navy has tanks all over the world. All over. This is nothing new. You do not have to get in there and involve. All you gotta do is be the parent. Tell them, Navy, I like what you're doing. Can you make this happen faster? Can you do a better job? What are you doing? Don't have to get in there. You don't have to review this stuff. They have resources all over that can figure this thing out. Don't buy into them. Be the top parent and tell them unacceptable, unacceptable. We'll figure it out.
So many soldiers that we attack, you know. But, you know, that's the way it goes. Well, this is our
children's health and safety. So where's the congressional committee? Why aren't they on the Navy? You know, why aren't they like, look, you know, you are risking the safety of this community. And where's the Clean Water Act? Why isn't that being enforced here? Why are they getting away? It's a multiple dimension question, but it's all related. And how do we make our congressional committee to do their job? You know, they're just sitting there and doing nothing. They're letting the Navy mess us around because we can't do anything against the Navy, but they could be doing something against the Navy. They've got, you know, more power than we do. And we can like say, yes, we'll write letters if we're concerned, but they should have some, you know, ability to tell the Navy, you can't contaminate the water. Just, we'll let you know in 27 years that we're gonna fix it. You know, so that's kind of multiple dimension question.
Yeah, the main lead working with us through the underground sewage tank program is the safe drinking water program. So it's under a separate act because part of the focus is the impact of groundwater and it's potentially a drinking water source. So we've engaged geologists from the safe drinking water act. We've been looking at installation of these new wells, making sure they're done correctly, and we get the most accurate information. How we can improve the network around the radio facility. Moanalua well number two, which is closest to tank number five, has historically been the area where we've seen elevated levels. It goes up, drops back down, goes up. We saw the most significant occurrences in 2013. There are vapor Moanalua wells directly under the tanks. So that confirmed that a release occurred because we saw a huge spike in vapors being released from there. We haven't seen that kind of vapor response since then. We believe that the fuel is out there, it's sitting there. Every time we have rainfall in it, it seems like some of it gets pushed into the drinking water. It hits the drinking water, we see the thing drop over time. And part of the things we suspect is that we see oxygen levels in that well drop and pick up, suggesting that the bugs in the groundwater are effectively knocking down the stuff that's coming down to the drinking water. But you see that fluctuation occurring. So part of it is there. Short of putting hundreds of wells in the area, trying to look for the leak, I think we still, one of the things that we're looking at is the next focus is destructive testing, taking apart one of the tanks. What's happening on the outside of the steel? How badly is it corroding? Are there areas where they're thinning? There's bad joints. Like I said, there's 2.5 feet of concrete that encases these tanks. What's the condition of that concrete? Is it effectively holding the fuel in so that it goes straight down as opposed to breaking out and going out into the dry rock and then somehow over time reaching groundwater. These are features that we're focusing on right now. So, getting a better feel, finding out, you know, the name, we told the name of Joseph Holes, you know, Gary volunteered taking his hand show and Joseph Holes in the steel tank, and they wouldn't let him do it, you know. And part of that is so frustrating because I think that's what he needs. If you found the leak, then let's take that steel plate and see what happened. Where did it go? Did it go out? Did it go straight down? And we can then develop better operational plans for the Navy to make goals.
Can I jump in? Just so you can think on it. I thought your question was actually a rhetorical one, because I think you know what we gotta do is raise hell so that the politicians, you know, have to pay attention. I mean, it's unfortunate that something this important, you know, requires that kind of mobilization, but unfortunately I think that's what it's going to take. You know, it's astonishing to learn that the tanks there are less sophisticated than the ones in our service station. You know, and yet they're sitting 100 feet above this aquifer with, you know, 187 million gallons of fuel. I think we've learned enough now since they were built that you wouldn't put that kind of fuel storage over an aquifer. I hope we would have learned that. But now that we have a chance to fix it, right? Like, why don't we look at alternatives? I mean, I don't have figures. I've been trying to find out, but I don't think that these tanks are being used at the same level that they once were, right? So let's look at a process for decommissioning with dignity, right? Yeah, I'm kind of impressed that these things are kind of an engineering feat, right? But let's clean them up, turn them into a monument or amusement park, even housing, right? I mean, not gamble with the future, of drinking water and children's health. I think that that's unacceptable. One of the things that they were talking about, we have different options. One is like to shut them down, drain them down, period. Like, that should be the first priority. But there is, there's another tank there's another set of tanks that are huge that were piped all the way down from Punya side all the way to Hickam. And that one is closed down and they've been going through a process of cleanup. There's spills there that they're dealing with. And then they have to run these devices that go through the tanks to beam it out and clean up the stuff that's in there. So it's possible to do that. And I think, start now rather than wait 20 years and then decide. Right, so you have old ships that get a dignified decommissioning and they get turned into monuments or museums or whatever. Why can't we do something similar with this? Like, why are we putting it, so much at stake, putting all of us at risk of these 73-year-old tanks?
Hi, my name is H. Doug Matsuo, the Hawaii Gorilla Video of Hui. I like being behind the camera, so I have the camera pointed at you guys. Now, Kyle kind of touched on the question that I wanted to ask, and I had a number of questions, and let me try and squish it into one question. We know these tanks are bad, we know they're leaking, we know they represent a hazard, we know they have to, the situation has to be fixed, and we know what has to be done, but actually, realistically, given the size of the military, of the Navy, their influence on the economy and on government here, actually, what is it going to take? I mean, what is it actually going to take? What do we actually have to do to get it fixed? And it can be an opinion and it can be from any of you.
Okay, well, the admission order and consent is real specific about that. They have to identify a viable tank upgrade alternative. Once they identify that, they have to go to Congress. Like any other project they propose, they have to get the funding from Congress. And that is maybe an answer back to you, is that we will have to rely on our congressional delegation to push hard. Because the Navy's telling us a normal process for contract work to be done, there's a 5-year cycle. So even though we identify a remedy, it will take them up to potentially 5 years to get the funding to be able to start the work. So when you look at that, you say, well, wait a minute, that means they get the money 5 years from now, they have to put it up to 7 years before any work gets done. So, but again, can it be done in 4 years, 3 years? Can we get enough push from our congressional delegation to make it happen there? In the meantime, there are 13 tanks that have never really gone through this modernization process of inspecting every inch inside the tank, looking for bad wells, looking for things from people dropping equipment and stuff like that. That work can be done now. Nothing precludes the Navy from doing that. And in several conversations, they're talking about if they're going to do any repairs to these tanks in the future, that work has to be done first. You have to make sure that the existing 73 still is operational and the areas that are weak or defective get replaced. There's one alternative is to take out that old steel and replace with new steel. Having better workmanship done, that can improve the overall safety of that, but again, is it viable as opposed to putting in two walls of steel? part of it is that you build and upgrade. One of the things you have to do is you have to be able to inspect, repair, and maintain it for the next 30, 50 years if you're going to operate. So if they can't come up with a solution with that, then it becomes really hard for them to be able to operate these tanks because time will run out. They've got 20 years to do these upgrades. They can use only the tanks that go through this upgrade process. Any tanks that after the 20-year period cannot be used at all until they actually do work. So if they get through the 20-year process and do 5 tanks, that's all they'll be allowed to use. And I think the Navy realized that they're pushing hard, they're pushing on us to move to get the work done because they want to get to a point where they can look at the bottom line and figure out where they proceed. What's the dollar amount that's going to cost to do specified repair. The other thing is that every 5 years, we go back and look at, was the past repair work, the upgrades acceptable? Are there new technologies out there, new kinds of materials that can be replaced? And if they are selected, then they can't use the old technology, they have to use the new technology.
Yes, I think the next time. Can you repeat your question so I can
Yeah, well, given the, we know the bad stuff about the tanks, we know they're bad, we know ways to fix this situation, we know it has to be fixed, but given the size of the military and of the Navy and their influence on the economy and the government, what's it going to take to get this actually done? What do we have to do? What can anyone do?
I think it'll take
the question,
given the size of the military, and their importance to our community, what can we do to make this happen, to address this situation right here?
That's pretty good. That's pretty good.
Okay. So you're right. The Navy is a big player in our economy. They bring a lot of money and jobs to our economy. They have an important role in our national defense here in the Pacific.
They can also just say, no, we don't want to do it. They're building bases out in Okinawa, and they have thousands of people saying no, but they continue in this. So what can we force them to be responsive to the community that we live in?
Erwin and I did some research on this, on other communities that have faced maybe not as bad a situation as the situation with the huge tanks at Red Hill. But similar situations, and we found one in Albuquerque, New Mexico. We've gone there a couple times to actually speak to those people, the utility there, and also the elected officials, both at the local government, state, and federal level. It's clear that it's the community that needs the state to get educated, to actually become more active in this issue, and to be able to voice those concerns about the need for timely, quick solutions. And in Albuquerque, that was what happened. And one of the congressional representatives from New Mexico made Red Hill their number one issue.
I see.
And they were able to move the military. In that case, it was the Air Force at Kirtland Air Force Base. In our case, it's the U.S. Navy. Ultimately, it is going to take our elected officials, and we have a number of them in the room, and I really appreciate them coming out to be educated about this, to hear your Moanalua. But it is going to take elected officials from local level all the way up to the federal level to get involved, to get on the same plate of concern that the rest of the community at the Board of Water Supply has about protection of the resource, and to put pressure at the at the Hill in Washington, D.C., either to get the funds or also to pressure the military to take quicker action. And I would agree with the gentleman that explained this process with the OPNAV 59.1 and the ability for our military to do things. We have the best military in the world. They can do nearly impossible things. And the Red Hill fuel tanks is not an impossible thing, which
right.
I believe they can take care of this problem if they have the will to do it. So it's a team that we get them and our federal representatives to have that will to do something and prevent a disaster.
Thank you, that answered me.
Okay, so I'm gonna do a written question. There's two of them, but there's some others, so it's gonna be, I'm gonna put them together. What is the total of leaks over the years, and has any of that fuel been cleaned up?
Total number of leaks over the years?
Over the years.
So. That's a real hard one. I've looked at reports I could get my hands on the industries. And, you know, I go away looking at these reports, scratching my head because it doesn't make any sense to me, some of the things. Some reports say, yes, we lost 32,000 gallons at this tank on this, in this period of time. Some others say, well, there were, this tank was dripping 6 drops per minute, and that's all it says. Was it for like a day, a year? 10 years, I have no idea because information is very loosely written. The techniques they utilize in building this tank is extremely complicated, and trying to understand why, what was happening, were they getting false positives, where they had a very rudimentary leak detection system. A lot of people think that it actually was the reason why they had reports released. But it's not clear. The one thing we know is that when the Navy actually began their exploration under the wells, they found stinking fuel stains under 19 of the 20 tanks.
Oh, man.
And the tank number didn't find any contamination. I went through a record in 1983 reports where they had releases from the tank. So what does that mean? It's that, well, the well they got or the coordinated under tank number 10 just missed the same area. So, and the Navy admitted to that, said, look, we just said there's a release from every tank. There's no error on it. So, but again, actually coming up with a real number is, we'll never be able to find that. The record of releases, from what I can see, ended around 1983, and it's really since 83 this has been first certified quantifiable release that we can put our finger on.
If I can maybe try to assist in our review of the records, I'm going to ask Mr. Gerard Kawata to come up. He's done a review of thousands of pages of documents. Or maybe, I know you have a table, we actually have a slide that explains, and it's caveated by, it doesn't validate the information that we've seen that is accurate, but if you were to assume that everything was leaking, maybe Aaron, you can go up to that. What do you think is the rough amount of fuel that leaked?
There is a table in a report called the 2008 Groundwater Protection Plan. That table shows the number of fuel leaks by the Navy. It dates from 1947 up to 1985. And there are various kinds of reports, so many drops, there are actual quantities, so many gallons. So if you just take all the gallon numbers, and if you assume that they're all correct, between 1947 to 85, you add them all up, I come out with about 206,000 gallons for that period of time.
Wow.
And that is, unvalidated, but it is probably the best number we can get out of the Navy's report.
Well, my name is Alan Bird. I have a procedural question that I think may be helpful to folks here. It was not clear to me when I first came exactly what the status of this meeting is vis-a-vis the AOC itself, particularly because it was mentioned that there will be another meeting on October 6th, also here. Are these meetings mandated by the AOC? Are they merely informational meetings for the public? Or is there something that may come out of these meetings that may have an effect that will cause an amendment to the AOC. It's just not clear whether this is more than simply a public informational meeting. Important though that is, we just get a sense of, you know, do we have any power here in essence?
If I can take a stab at that, yes, you have power here.
Yes!
To be really technical about it, no, this is just a bunch of community members getting together and sharing information, comparing notes. I think one of the things that we've learned in researching other communities that have confronted these kinds of spills is that they were very well organized and they worked together with their elected officials and their appointed officials to come to solutions to really protect their drinking water. And from my perspective, I feel that's what we need. And so this is an attempt to help community members come together, hear some of the information from the experts, and then talk about what we could do in terms of next steps and solutions. And so we have an opportunity to sign up if you are interested in being more involved. There are note cards going around, as well as a sign-in sheet. We are looking for people to be more involved, and that's the goal of this meeting, information and involvement. But this is not mandated by anybody or anything except their own public push. The Sierra Club gets calls on a regular basis about this issue, and people want to know what's going on, so we feel an obligation as part of our own mission to speak up and step up. The October 6th meeting is an annual update, right?
Yes.
So that is mandated under the AOC, at least one annual
meeting. Thank you.
Good question.
Hello, my name is Shaker from Havana. I have a question for the audience. Is there anybody in here representing Governor Nevey's office? Would you stand? Anybody representing Lieutenant Governor? Anybody representing the state legislature on the Senate side?
Hey.
Anybody on the House side? One right there. Mayor's office? Anybody from Mayor? What about the city council? Yeah, so this is, anybody representing our federal people? Our congressional people? Anybody? Okay, so this is what this meeting is for. It's for us to light a little match or the pin and stick them right underneath their opole. Yeah, that's what this kind of meeting is for. Because they're not here. Have the pin or the match, one of the two. All of them should be standing behind them. Not on this side, they should be standing behind them and say, I support what they are doing.
Yeah.
Now, I remember when David Peters used to work with Senator Danny Noy, and he was a man of all of those characters, right up here. Yeah. And he would have fought them. PACAP is over here. All of the Pacific headquarters for the military is right here. If we are smart enough, like we are, we can go out to PACAP and pick those guys up until Navy surrenders and they'll be able to face it. Right? We can do that. PACAP is here. PACAP is our neighbor. Those guys at Pacific headquarters live in our neighborhood. We know what kind of cars they drive. We know where their kids go to school. Yeah, so what I'm saying is, this is supposed to be about getting them out and making sure they're doing things one of them. Because Hawaii, you know, the
hey. Right.
name is Jennifer Rachels, and I'm a combat veteran. I'm currently clearly not from here. You can tell from the way that I talk, but I currently live here. I'm a full-time student on the GI Bill at HBU, getting an MBA and a master's in sustainable development. This is an issue that concerns me because as a veteran, it's personally embarrassing, but also it concerns me as a professional because this is the sort of thing that I'm going to be dealing with for the rest of my life. So my questions are, I have two questions. One is, in terms of communication with the public, have you learned from other communities that have communicated with their military families directly? And are you using those tools so that they will be educated and motivated to do something about this? And the second question is, what's next? And it kind of falls under Dylan's question here. If this agreement doesn't come to where we need it to, what's the next?
There is a process of dispute resolution to come to a solution to agree, but nothing in the agreement says that Department of Health and the EPA cannot walk away from this. It would be difficult, but I believe we should be able to evoke that if necessary. But again, we still have probably 18 more months to see actually all the pieces come together, and we can see if it makes sense. Is the solution viable? Can they get it off the ground? Can they be forward? And can we get it done in the time that we have?
What about communicating with military families about what they might
be missing? Well, the Navy says they keep sending out flyers to their the Navy families because roughly the fuel, drinking water that comes from the Red Hill shaft goes directly to military facilities. So I think it does provide 27% of fuel, 27% of drinking water for the Pearl Harbor area. So.
And also the golf course, the Navy Marine golf course, and the one little shopping area down by the Navy Exchange. So those are also being fed with that water. So it is
like where the school is.
Yeah, exactly. Right, so, you know, I mean, yeah, I think the concern for military families is a very important one. Schofield was a case where contaminants were going to put in the drinking water was, exposing military families to toxins. Right now in Mocapo and Cañone, there's issues around housing and some of the contaminants there that are affecting families. So I think we haven't, at least from the community side, I feel like we need better contacts and networks to try to reach out to those families to have that dialogue. So if you have ideas or networks that we could plug into, I think that'd be great. I haven't been as active on this issue as the Sierra Club has, so I really thank them for helping get this together. And I'm trying to get up to speed myself. Absolutely, the military families is a crucial constituency to reach out to and organize. Can I just add one thing about this? I think the purpose of a meeting like this is, you know, it's obviously not an official mandated meeting where we can get some sort of results on the record. But I think it's so important that communities talk to each other, that we. One, build relationships, two, just become aware, because what I've found with, especially contaminants, is that they're invisible, you don't see them, and so it's a kind of a threat that's hidden in plain sight, and unless you can make them, you know, sort of tangible for folks, it doesn't register as a problem, and if a politician doesn't feel heat from something like that, they also won't register this as a priority. So, you know, how do we create that political will to do something, to get the money, to fight hard for the best and highest cleanup as possible? And it takes, I think, concerned community members raising those voices. So this is really an important meeting in that respect.
think we share similar concerns. One of the things that I actually had two questions with you in love with respect. The first one's kind of more an observation. I wasn't sure exactly what happened was with this meeting, so I actually thought maybe you would be here as well, because I have a question that I want to ask that I think the other experts could have kind of keep each other in check on how they respond to us, right? We talk about how my analysis is something Michael Bodley went to practice on the YNX and facilitate as well. So that is not a criticism or anything, that was just an observation of what I had hoped to kind of get robust information on.
We'll bring it to the next slide.
Yeah, but I was going to ask, is there plans for that next time? And the second thing was more technical, I think, is on the fuel, right? All fuel is not the same. So if the cleanup was not a priority for them, did they say why? And then do you know what the breakdown of the compounds or the components in there versus the longevity of life that we need to be concerned about?
Any questions?
Most of the chemicals being measured in the groundwater are measured in parts per billion or parts per trillion. We have a cleanup level for TPH diesel, which is 100 parts per billion. And actually, that's based on the fact that if you actually had a container containing 100 parts per billion, you can taste it. It's not a thing that will cause you to die, but you can taste it. We have had other releases throughout the United States. MTBE was an additive put into gasoline in California. If you have enough concentration of that when you're taking a shower in the hot water, you can actually smell it in your bath. We've since then banned the use of MTBE in the United States. But again, the concentrations, you know, we continue monitoring. We see the one hot spot is at monitoring number 2, which is located near tank number 5. We see the concentrations drop off as it moves down toward the drinking water well. We have looked at the reports. Much of the stuff is at the detection level of the equipment. We see problems with sampling. We're trying to improve it. We've actually had samples or testing where the blank samples were not even taken from Red Hill show levels of contamination because we believe it's potentially contamination in the lab, or just that they're at that very fine point where you're looking at the detection capability of the equipment. So it's something we're still working on to figure out how we can improve it. We feel that right now, using the 12 contaminants that are, you know, we see a number there, we know it's there. You know, we're chasing some of the things that we have no evidence we're ever using in the regular facility. You know, you're not going to see them, or they could be little blips on a chart. And you know, people are scratching their head. Is it there or isn't it? They don't know. But clearly, things like PPH diesel, naphthalene, we see them present. We see them fluctuating over time, and we see it still at very low levels. One of the things that maybe communicates to their group, their naval community, is for water safety drink. And it is still safety drink. But it doesn't mean that there are very low levels of material moving in the groundwater. And one of the key things is for us to get that better network of wells outside of simply in the middle of the tunnel. Couple of wells just outside of the tunnel, look out into the aquifer, find out what else is there. Have we missed any spots? Are there hot spots that have been missed by previous work by the meeting?
Can I answer sort of a follow on Steve's
So you mentioned the action level for the TPH diesel was 100 parts per billion, but there's a site-specific, it was elevated to 4,500 for the site-specific risk-based level or something like that.
That's correct.
So what? How did that happen? And why can't we just keep it at that more stringent 100 parts per billion and, you know, make the Navy meet that?
Yeah.
The focus is on the drinking water source and what's in the drinking water source. We have what appears to be an active release from tank number 5, and that's why we see those spikes. You know, but we see it spike and we see it drop down, and you know, the best we can determine is that you may have large, or you may have a the fuel can be trapped in the rock above the aquifer. It's sitting there. It's not like a sponge. There are various layers of lava rock basalt. You know, basalt, we found some very thick layers of basalt that are not very porous, and we find loose rock, which is called clinker zones, rocks, pebbles and granites over time, and we see different layers over the area above the groundwater, and we believe that fuel is moving, but it's getting trapped in this area. And when you have rainfall, water comes into contact with these potential globs of fuel, and there's a capability to dissolve some of it on the odd reaches, and that is what we're seeing in the groundwater. So we're continuing monitoring. We're concerned that it's spiked up. We've seen most recently drop back down again, so it keeps doing this. And we're trying to do some correlations. Is it affected by rainfall? What are other factors that could cause this? We know it's there, but it's not moving. We're not seeing spikes in the monitoring wells, downgrading well number 2.
Gary wanted to say something
before you jump in. The question was, what was the rationale behind the higher site specific?
Oh, what was the rationale behind the 4,500 parts per million?
So maybe does a risk evaluation looking at if we had a mobile source of ethanol, which is it has an affinity to water, so it's easily mixed to water. Think of ethanol as buying vodka. Mix it with water, right? It mixes well together. And the idea is that if you have an ethanol release, looking at how long it would take for that material to get down to the drinking water source, they then back calculate and said, well, look at TPH diesel levels up to 4,500. Their estimate is not going to move in any significant time to get to the drinking water source. So they came up with the site-specific risk-based level. This is looking at what level concentration can you allow in an upgrading well, knowing the ability for the thing is mobility, to see what can you allow at higher levels above that 100 ppm, ppb that will not cause an impact to the drinking water source.
And the drinking water source is the Red Hill Shaft?
Red Hill Shaft. There's just about 1,500 feet from bottom of tank number 1.
So for a board of water supply, we still have a problem with the 4,500, which doesn't make sense to us, because it shouldn't be the risk of that fuel traveling to the Red Hill Shaft that should govern the 4,500 being sent, but it should be degrading of a pure resource. The resource below those tanks, before the tanks went into operation, was pure fresh water.
Yeah.
No fuel.
Yeah.
So if anything is used, and I guess I would like to see the trigger 100 is much more conservative or precautionary, and that if it hits 100 or higher, they should look at remediation.
Awesome.
Clean enough.
Yeah.
Each tank stands 250 feet tall. This was the tank. 250 feet tall. 100 feet below it is the water table here, my blue pen. The tank leaks could occur anywhere in the tank. And this whole area of rock underground, the lava rock, there's anywhere between 300 to 350 feet of unsaturated lava rock above the water table down here. We've advocated that they should do investigation to determine if there's fuel trapped in this unsaturated lava rock, because it's going to be easier to remove that than when it gets into the water and dissolves into the water. Once it's dissolved into the water, it's much more difficult to remove. Unfortunately, people have agreed to disagree on that. So we still advocate for this unsaturated zone or beta zone needs to be investigated, and if fuel's located in that unsaturated beta zone, it gives us the prime opportunity to have the Navy try to remove that before it seeps down into the water. The other thing about fluctuating levels in the various wells, remember these are 10 locations, 10 monitor wells. If this was now a monitor well number two, and the levels in this monitor well fluctuates, goes high and goes low. The thing to remember is that the groundwater underground is moving. It doesn't sit still. So it just may be that the peak of the contaminant plume has moved past or is moving past the location that's being measured. And Red Hill currently only has about 10 locations where they're measuring. The example I use is Kirtland Air Force Base in Albuquerque, New Mexico. Erwin, how many monitor wells have been drilled now?
210. Wow.
210 okay. Monitor wells. So we believe that there is the need to drill more of these wells to define the nature and extent of the fuel contamination that's moving with the groundwater underground. And there's also the need to investigate the beta zone, the unsaturated zone in the lava rock, where there may be fuel that's trapped there, and as rain falls on that ridge, as the Ua falls, it's pushing that fuel down and feeding the groundwater and contaminating the groundwater. So that's where we agreed to disagree, I guess, at this point.
I'm sort of in the middle, like,
see, you're in the middle. I wish you were more.
How are you?
think it was January of this year.
January of this year, okay. And then there was one in April of last year, I think. So, what are the health effects? I understand you said when you're down here, oh, maybe you can taste it, but there are no health effects.
Yes, actually in 2014, they shut down the tank, they removed the fuel, it's not been in use.
Okay, that one tank, but obviously there's still a problem. So I just mean in general, is there a number at which Department of Health can say, I'm sorry, you cannot do this anymore?
I have to go back and talk to my guys. Okay, is there an upper limit of the number?
Was there a legal trigger for it, something like that?
Legal trigger?
No, there's no real legal trigger. I mean, we look at releases that happen and look at what we apply in aerospace for protection. What can you do? We have lots of cleanup sites where we allow contamination to remain in the ground because you can't get anywhere for it yet, but then the question is, can you put in controls to make sure that whatever is there is going to stay there and isn't going to move?
EPA passed underground storage regulations that took away a lot of facilities like where the field constructed underground storage tanks. So the Department of Health has the opportunity to pass rules that at least comply with the EPA's requirements, and we hope will actually stricter. And it gives them the legal authority and legal clout to hold the Navy accountable. So we're going to be advocating, recommending, making some recommendations when we go through that rule adoption process to try to strengthen the underground storage tank regulations.
But if they got to a level, what does it cause? What do we look for?
Yeah, part of the Navy contingency plan is that if they began seeing elevated concentrations in their drinking water source, they would apply treatment because...
What are the health consequences of the increased levels of pollution? What is it that people would expect to see? What health consequences would we see?
I can't tell you off the top of it because my focus has been not to let it get to that concentration and get the Navy to put in treatment before that occurs. Now, you know, let's face it, you know, we've been on this island for years and years and years. We've had sugar pineapple production for 120 years or so until they all went out of business. But they contributed to a lot of our contamination in the Central Plain. We're still paying for that, and we try to develop residential housing. We find elevated chemicals as the water supply continues pumping water from many of their wells. We're finding the effects of the 100 years of the application of fertilizers and herbicides. And unfortunately, the only thing we can do is prevent the threats to our community is continue pumping that water because it's a source of water, but treat it to a point where we know it is safe.
I think that in terms of the health effects, part of the problem with this TPH diesel or the fuel, there are no drinking water standards nationally set by the EPA. So we suggested the need to do more study in this area. It's a suggestion we made to the parties that are signatory to the EOC that they look at the health effects, because that also speaks toward what are the possible consequences of fuel contamination. So, Steve, you want to bring that back to to the discussions in San Francisco. As part of the risk, because if you're going to do a risk and vulnerability assessment, how do you do it if you don't know what the consequences are?
Exactly, the question.
But again, you know, our toxicologists have looked at their literature. Coming up the 100 came through looking at all different researches done through the through the world, looking at what numbers gives us a sense of its potential risk to society, and the number that we settled on is 100 because it represents a taste factor, not a carcinogenic risk, but a fact that if you can taste your water or something not right, you know, just like if you smell your hair, it's not right. It's the same battle we deal with, you know, and coming to that balance and saying, okay, if it's there, we cannot let it, if it gets our drinking water, we have to apply treatment to get rid of it. And actually, it feels like this are easily removed.
One thing I want to say is that large-scale agriculture in central Oahu and newer Oahu, all of us as drinking water customers were paying that price. We still, 30 years later, maybe 40 years later, after they stopped using those chemicals for pineapple and sugarcane, we're still having to pay for the cost of treatment. So if people ask the question, why should I care about Red Hill? Because I don't live near Red Hill. I don't drink the water out of the wells nearby. But the cost of treatment will be spread among all of our customers, so we all bear the cost. Like we're bearing the cost of all the contamination decades ago in Central Oahu, we're still treating to this day using activated carbon. We use about 1 million pounds of activated carbon to clean up the water each year. And we will still continue doing that for years to come. We don't see an end.
Does activated carbon take out diesel fuel?
In the Navy's 2010 study, they did a 2010 study if they had to install a treatment system in Red Hill Shaft, their drinking water shaft, which provides 25% of the water for Joint Base Pearl Harbor Hickam. They used, they found activated carbon and what they call air stripping, trying to aerate the water and using carbon to clean it.
So the technology exists and is proven to keep the water safe at your wells.
If we have to go down that route, that's what we would have to look at. Depending on how high the levels of fuel are in that water, remember at Red Hill you have 187 million gallons of fuel there. Depending on how much fuel gets into the water and reaches our wells, the treatment systems may be effective, or if it's too high,
it's
may
too
be
high,
ineffective.
Yeah.
Then we're looking at the other expensive option, drilling wells someplace away from the area of contamination, which we don't want to do. That's why we advocate for prevention here. It's better to prevent than to deal and react to a catastrophic fuel release.
Okay, well, one more question. My name is David Jones. I've been going to all these Red Hill meetings concerning this, taking seriously. I live in the area, and also it's a very important issue. During these meetings, I'm just kind of disappointed. I thank the Sierra Club for putting on this meeting. Public meetings are very important to get out of our board to the public to make informed decisions. I'm disappointed in most of these meetings that I go to. You have one side of the issue, have a meeting, the other side has their meeting, and they don't come together. I wanted to know why the Navy and the EPA wasn't invited to this meeting today. It would have been a great meeting. And any on the panel answer that?
So we organized this meeting and we decided that the thing that we could add most to the conversation was something that focused on our local officials and our local knowledge, and that didn't have all of the other meetings that we've gone to. The Navy has been there, and it's gotten contentious because they don't necessarily like us saying things that, you know, challenge their well, their storage tanks being there. And so we thought that this might provide a more of an informal and
Q&A process for the community to get their questions answered. But, you know, we also heard from other people that they would like to have a meeting here, and so we are open to hosting future meetings, but we thought this was a good opportunity to give people the chance to get some information and, you know, a safe place to ask tough questions.
There were here a lot of the questions that was asked tonight could have been answered, and the public would make their informed decision what's going on, who's going to settle this situation and put an end to this finally. And ultimately, it's going to be the public that's going to get the answer to that question. So with these meetings, like I say again, it's very important to have these public meetings, but all players need to be at the table so the public can answer, ask their questions and get an answer. Thank you.
Okay, so with that, I think we'll wrap it up because it's almost 9 o'clock and we need to zero.
I want to mahalo you guys, Uncle Ben. This is going to be our second question. So for those who still have questions, you can write them down. Give them to Kristen right over here. And we'll take them and we'll make sure that the Board of Water Supply, Department of Health, as well as our Kyle, get the questions. I just want to mahalo you guys for sticking with us in this conversation. This is something that we are going to continue to engage our community, create the awareness and engage and elevate this so that more people know what's going on, okay? But first I want to mahalo, just in the back corner here, we have some ulu poi and some luau stew, cassava luau stew. It was all locally sourced, a mile away from our friend, our mommy, the Luz at Kaonohi Farm. Regarding Red Hill, so we have what we call Sierra Club Lahana. If you guys would like to come, we have a work day where it's real simple. We work together, we eat together, and then we talk about Red Hill. That's part of our grassroots efforts that we've been doing. I'll mahalo our panel and our speakers for coming out. Mahalo all of our volunteers and our community members for coming out and sticking with us tonight. I want to remind each and every one of you that this is not the end, but just the beginning, okay? How you guys can get started is by, we have some petitions here that I have right here. We have some petitions over there as well, where we're demanding that the Navy, first off, and the EPA find the 27,000 gallons of jet fuel and clean that up at first, right? Because we all know, when we teach our kiki, I'm a father of three. When my daughter spills something, right, when she has a cup of juice and she spills it on the ground, we tell her, baby, go clean that up. We don't allow her to go back and say, you know what, take 20 years to study that one. Right? So something that we can equate to that. I want to remind you guys that if you guys have smartphones, or you guys on social media, you guys can follow us on our Sierra Club Facebook page. We're going to be putting the contents of tonight's meeting, as well as our friend Doug here has been live streaming it. So we're gonna make sure we get this out to you. Mahalo to Brother Oren as well, who's joining us. I wanna mahalo Brother Norman, our sound guy, who's been helping us here. And the last thing I want you guys to do, if you guys haven't so already, again, go to our Sierra Facebook page, follow us on there, like us on there, and then let's stay connected. Now, over this past 2 weeks, myself and many of us have begun to go out into the community. So you'll see us at Salt Lake Shopping Center. You're gonna see us at Stadium Mall Shopping Center. You've seen us at CAM Shopping Center, at IS Shopping Center, and guess what? Planning on going to the NEX. The comment that they made about the Navy and the Navy families are our families. That's right, there are more Navy families living off base than living on base. And so as we begin to engage these families, as Jennifer had said, they're part of the fold. We are all one. So I want to mahalo you guys for coming out. Please get some more food. Yeah. Please get some more food and stay connected with us.
Thank
mahalo
you.
You guys mahalo. Get home safely. And if you guys would like to, October 6th. Yep, October 6th is the Board of Water, Department of Health, and the annual meeting for Red Hill. The EPA and the Navy will be coming. Mahalo, everyone.
Great. Thank you. That was it. We've been live streaming. You're here live. Had some spotty bandwidth, but most of it been good. We've had Kyle Kajihiro, Stephen Chang, Board of, State Department of Health, and the Ernie Lau on the water supply. Thanks.